Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Rausen Pereira. Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Saturday launched the Atmanirbhar Innovation Challenge, inviting India's tech and community to create an Atmanirbhar app ecosystem. The challenge will be regulated under the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology along with Atal Innovation Mission and run in two tracks: promotion of existing apps and development of new apps. Under track one, the government will work in mission mode for identifying good quality apps for the leaderboard and shall be completed in around 1 month. This will include existing apps and platforms in categories like e-learning, work from home, gaming, business, entertainment, etc. Under track two, the government will work to help create new champions in India by providing support in ideation, incubation, prototyping and rollout along with market access. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze if the Indian IT sector is ready for the innovation challenge. Joining me on the program today are Sarita Rai, South Asia Technology Correspondent, Bloomberg, R. Ramanan, Mission Director, Atal Innovation Mission, Niti Aayog, and Jitin Jain, Digital Technology Expert, is also with us on the program. Thank you, all of you, for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. All right, Mr. Ramanan, let me start the program with you first, and let's first try and understand and analyze the innovation challenge itself. Tell us more about it.
Thank you, and good morning to everybody. And it is indeed a privilege to participate in this discussion. The Atmanirbhar Bharat App Innovation Challenge is a need of the times in India. And it is definitely one at this point in time, because the Indian IT industry has grown remarkably over the last 10 to 15 years. So we are now a $180 billion ITS industry. But at the same time, there has been a lacuna in creating world-class apps from India. The talent is there, the capability is there, the companies are there, but we do want to make sure that in this, especially when you look at the COVID-19 crisis and beyond, and the way technology has advanced over the last several years, becoming affordable, accessible, available, and advanced. And you have a mobile revolution that has happened in our country. It is but very important that we are able to create and nurture as well as grow world-class apps that are not only used to meet India's requirement from an Atmanirbhar or a self-reliant point of view, but also from an international and a global point of view. Because we are, after all, our ITS industry is serving the global market. And therefore, there is no reason for us to doubt our capability and innovative quotient in being able to come up with world-class meaningful apps. And therefore, the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, MyGov, and Atal Innovation Mission have jointly partnered to be able to create this challenge or set of challenges, which we think will have an excellent response from the industry. And as you rightly pointed out, there is already many existing apps in India. Unfortunately, some of them or many of them have not come to light. And if there are world-class apps that are already out there, this gives a unique opportunity to those app creators to be able to showcase in the 8 categories that we have mentioned in the application. And of course, there are new apps that can be created to meet the challenges of multiple areas, whether it is in agriculture, whether it is wellness, whether it is telemedicine, whether it is educational technology, whether it is news, or whether it is in social innovation, good. So all of these will get an opportunity and an impetus through this Atmanirbhar Bharat App Innovation Challenge launched by the Honorable Prime Minister, to be able to find expression.
Sarita, let me come across to you. I mean, we heard Mr. Ramanan, he's, you know, telling us about how there is the talent, there is the capability really as far as our IT sector is concerned. But what is it that is holding our tech companies back?
Frank, I think capital has been the biggest challenge for Indian startups. In the previous generation of IT services companies, they had a business model that brought in the cash and they've grown organically and they've haven't needed either venture or debt capital. Not so for startups, which both need venture as well as debt capital. The startup funding ecosystem is not yet as mature as ecosystems, say, in China or in the United States. Nor are venture capital investors willing to take these risks and back investors because their rivals are really deep-pocketed American or Chinese giants. For instance, nobody would touch an Indian startup that would compete against the Amazon or Walmart online in the online retail segment, because these are large companies with deep pockets, and no Indian startup without a big backer can hold its own. So entrepreneurs themselves don't find it worth the risk because venture capitalists, for instance, are not willing to back them. And it's kind of a chicken and egg situation, Frank.
Okay, all right. Jitin Jain, taking the discussion forward now. So, what is the quality and standard of our existing apps? Now, that is something that the Innovation Challenge is looking at as well. And that's something that R. Ramanan spoke about in his opening remarks too. Your thoughts on the existing apps and how they need to scale up?
Look, Frank, there is no, clear answer to this, because if you were to, ask for, and I've been asked this question on many channels that, what is the quality of Indian apps? Can we compete with the global market? Are we at par with the famous global apps? Look, India, though maybe we may have been called the software superpower of the world for the last decade, we have primarily been a service industry. We have developed world-class applications, one of the best softwares in the world, but that all has been done for a foreign company where the innovation, ideation, or the conceptual design or architecture has been finalized by some, bigger giant sitting in US or China or Europe. And we only start coding and design what they have conceptualized. So in that context, where the quality checks or the ideation and design is of the Americans, and I mean, we are only serving, we are like laborers, just coding what they have said. So, I mean, those applications are of wonderful quality because they have to meet the European standards what the client asks for. Now, if you were to then compare the original Indian apps, we have some really good applications which are world-class. For example, you take Bheem, you take Paytm, you take Zomato. These applications are world-class applications, both in terms of UI design, usability, and security. But that is also because they have grown over a period of time. They have had their own challenges, and now they have got several rounds of funding. And as Sarita was rightly pointing out, it is end of the day is all about how much cash you have at your disposal to improve the quality and design and security. Now, then there is a third category. The applications which are really innovative, which are required, but they had no takers. For example, Indian video conferencing applications. I mean, nobody would, buy them or take them because either the Google Meets or Skype were available or free, or those who wanted, multiple people meeting, they went for Zoom. Now, suddenly, because of this banning of 59 applications, I mean, government has, I would not say they've created a level playing field. They've rather provided an empty field for Indian entrepreneurs. And there is an absolute vacuum for so many things, for micro-logging applications, for document scanning applications, which CAM scanner was banned, and for cleaning masters and stuff. So there is a huge, huge goal. I mean, I will say, not only space, but a golden age for Indian app innovators have arrived. Now, as Sarita and Sir pointed out, that's where Atal Innovation Mission comes in, that there are problems of scaling, there are problems of mentorship, there are problems of money, funding. I think government is trying to put up an ecosystem where they're not only able to identify talent, handhold them, take them through a market level, if required, provide them funding, if required, provide them the confirmed orders. For example, even before this Atal Innovation application came in, government had just, I think in the first month of lockdown, had launched a video conferencing innovation app challenge. And that had a very unique feature to it. Not only it carried a bounty or a prize, it also said whoever gets selected, multiple people will get funding, but whoever wins it will get confirmed order from the government, say, I think once a year for deploying it to the government departments. That is required. When you give them assured pipeline, even if it is a smaller one, that gives them a confidence to show to the market that we have successfully deployed our product and more customers will come in. So in that context, I would say that, we have absolute talent available, great skill set available in India, which had been used by foreign companies. Now the time has come that skill set is used or maybe, mentored by government by providing them finance and the bigger ecosystem enabling environment to ensure that innovation, ideation and the entrepreneurship or the rights or the ownership remains within India, and the Indians are the ones who capture the market.
Absolutely. And if I may add to that, the entire H-1B scenario in the US and the J-1 scenario also is something that is going to help us at this point in time. And hopefully we are going to see some real homegrown talent and homegrown apps that emerge in the near future. All right, taking the discussion forward now, Mr. Ramanan, so talking about the existing apps, have we identified what potential our existing apps have, and what is the agenda really for giving them a boost in phase one or track one?
Yeah, so thank you for that question. And I think the observations made by the fellow speakers are very pertinent in this. One is, you know, when Meti launched the search for the video app, it really got tremendous response and high quality, world-class response from many people. And that is what has actually, I would say, in a way, stimulated also this Bharat App Innovation Challenge. And therefore, when Meti and MyGov and Atal Innovation Mission got together to decide on this, one of the main factors in going into this is we are now a startup nation. And there is no doubt about it. We have 30,000 startups in our country. And this has been one of the fastest growing startup ecosystems in the country. Secondly, what we have found over the last 3 or 4 years is the very important part that there are many solutions which are out there. You know, when we, when Atal Innovation Mission, for example, launched the establishment of world-class incubators to foster world-class startups, just in a period of 2.5 years, more than 1,500 startups have got operationalized. Now, that doesn't happen just because you have 1,500 new ideas that have come up from scratch. Many of these startups were already out there and they were waiting for someone to be able to recognize them, provide them the ecosystem, provide them the initiative, help support them. And lo and behold, you have a fast-growing startup environment. Exactly in the same manner, in a manner of speaking, COVID-19, unfortunately, but if you view at it as an opportunity, has brought up and woken up the capabilities and the innovation of the startup world to the rest of the industry, including the private sector and so on. And recently, when the COVID-19 solutions for ready-to-deploy solutions was launched by a government task force, of which Atal Innovation Mission, DST, DBT, Startup India, Invest India, all of them are part of it, we found 1,500 ready-to-deploy solutions for COVID-19, which are preventive and assistive in nature, and many of them in the software world of contact tracing and so on and so forth, which were offered. And now it is being supported by the industry. So I think this particular Bharat App Innovation Challenge will actually bring to surface many existing apps which are out there, which have not somehow merited the attention that they deserve. And at the end of it, you have the government, which is a willing buyer. And there is this pillar that Honorable Prime Minister mentioned, you know, the 5 pillars, of which one of the most important pillars is the pillar of demand. The pillar of demand with 1.3 billion people as potential consumers of these products and these apps is such a huge draw that it is going not only to find expression through existing apps, but you're going to have a whole lot of new apps being created. Because at the end of the day, that demand fulfillment is through leveraging technology, digitalization, and that is the other pillar that he talked about. So when you talk about both of these, and then you talk about the third pillar of demand, which is infrastructure that he mentioned, where we need not only the physical infrastructure, but also the digital highway and the digital infrastructures. That digital infrastructure extends the power of the physical infrastructure to the remotest part of the country, whether it is a hilly district, coastal district, and so on. And people have access to those apps by which it interconnects, you know, a huge database based on analytics, satellite imagery, and so on. Take, for example, the poor farmer who is trying to make his farm doubly productive. If he has access, he or she has an access to an app which is going to make all the AI-based analysis and data available to them at their fingertips through a very intelligent app, you can see the impact that it can have. And that is what this track one is trying to ensure.
Okay, all right. So let's talk about innovation now and go back to the point that you were making in your opening remark, Saritara. You know, this issue of funding really and how it is a problem. But if you look at innovation as a whole, you know, even tech giants have been reluctant really to invest in R&D and to look to innovate further, especially back home in India, be it MNCs or even Indian tech giants? Why is that an issue, do you think?
Well, I don't think that is quite true, Frank. Indian engineers actually generate a vast amount of IP. The only thing is that this IP is generated, these patents are filed on behalf of multinational companies. It's not that Indians are not innovative. It's just that there is no ecosystem that supports them to innovate for India right now. But I think a couple of things have changed in the last few months. One is that coronavirus and Trump's ban on H-1B visas has actually created a situation where a lot of these engineers are looking to come back and actually start up in India or work for large startups or you know, work in even smaller startup teams where they are going to be able to play key roles. That is one thing. The second thing is that, of course, the government banning these 59 Chinese apps has created a playing field where Indian startups can actually go in and look for all of the, all of the segments where they can compete and actually have a level competing field. And thirdly, India is the world's second largest internet ecosystem. We have over 500 million internet users. If this isn't a market, what else is? You know, after the United States and after China, we are the world's second largest internet market. There is a market right here. We have the talent. All we need is now a little bit of, push from the government, I think, a lot of, support and entrepreneurs themselves having to come in and create these opportunities and scale them.
Okay, since we are here then, Jitin, so how do we create a conducive ecosystem that Sarita is talking about where innovation and ideas can thrive?
Look, Frank, one of the, biggest problems of startups was being able to sell their product. Let's be very honest and frank. This is Rajya Sabha TV, and I think we cannot talk about it. Our system was marred with bureaucracy and red tapeism. 10 years ago, if you were to sell something, an Indian product, you would not be even allowed to participate in tender because everybody would pay off money, bribe, the tenders will be manipulated, conditions would be put in like, a company should have minimum 100 CR turnover, you should have worked at least for the 10 clients in the government, you should have X, Y, Z, you should have at least 50 employees, you should have been in existence for 10 years. And these were the conditions no startup would ever be able to fulfill under no circumstances. So, there was a filtering of meritorious ideas just because certain people filled their pockets and ensured and manipulated the entire tender system. I think with the evolution of Digital India scheme and the startup ecosystem, which this government has delivered in the last 7 to 8 years, all these things have been, systematically taken care of. They have transformed the entire startup ecosystem. Today, a startup, even if there is a 50 CR, 100 CR turnover, requirement in a tender, startups and MSMEs are exempted. They are not supposed to pay those big hefty EMD deposits. They are not supposed to pay those, non-refundable tender fee. Even if they are not able to meet certain, I would say the experience criteria of working with the 10. If you are born today, how would you work for 10 governments, departments? So, that thing has been taken care of. You can just simply apply for Udyog Aadhaar or give a startup certificate and you will be given exemptions. And that is the most overarching reform this government has done for the entire startup ecosystem in India. And you can look at the results. Out of this 30,000 startups that Mr. Ramanan pointed out, if you were to analyze data of startups 10 years back, or whatever the numbers were available, many of them, once they succeeded, they would either go to Singapore or they'll shift to US. Or they will, get funding from US and they will open, they will never be headquartered in India for tax reasons or whatever. Today, because we can easily make a company, we can easily participate in government tenders. Government is willing to buy, give them a chance. Also, government is willing to give them tax credits. Startup, most innovative ones are getting tax holiday for 3 years. That has changed everything. Indian startups are not only succeeding and they're staying back in India. And now the final frontier of, assuring the sort of demand, assuring that you will have a supply line if you invest so much in this thing. that has been taken care of the government. There is 10,000 crore startup funds. I think that is one of the things where you are the money is available. I'm sure there are a lot of reforms to be done on that, but at least it's a good beginning. The last thing I would say, still, I mean, all this money and startup funds are coming in the form of loan. We are a country where you know, for generations, we have been taught not to borrow, rather to pool your own money so that risk is yours. So people would not invest in infrastructure like in US state. So one of the most important, you know, ideas with Niti Aayog has put out, and I think in the last report on IT and AI, is that they would create a cloud-based ecosystem where things like artificial intelligence or facial recognition systems or the storage would be provided on one centralized common government server, which would be very cheap. So right now what is happening is that if somebody is developing an AI-based app or a facial recognition app, they either buy Microsoft or either buy Amazon. They think it is cheaper, but what is happening at the back end is that it is Amazon and Microsoft which are using the data to train their own software, which is written in the agreements. Now, if this entire cloud-based ecosystem is provided by the government of India, not only a level playing, but a huge, you know, a cost support provided to the startups, but also our own government will learn to use their own data sets like of railways, facial recognition, toll taxes, innovate on the data and learn from the data and innovation of Indians. So I think it is the complete ecosystem which is now being put in place, both for the benefit of startup entrepreneurs and also for the benefit of government. So I think those building blocks are in place now. And whatever finishing that's been required, I think lockdown has forced all of us to do them in a very effective and timely manner. So I think it is the golden age for Indian startups.
Okay. Golden age for Indian startups is how Jitin is calling it, taking the discussion forward now. So let's talk about Mr. Ramanan, you know, the focus now or the spotlight on the IT sector. Whom is it going to benefit the most? Is it smaller tech firms? Is it startups or is it the tech giants? Who stands to benefit the most, do you think, going forward?
The very simple answer to is the ones who are most innovative and enterprising. It doesn't matter whether you are in the startup world, you are in the larger industry, you are an NGO. It really doesn't matter from where this innovation is coming in. And I think the biggest beneficiary is going to be what we have always been touting as a demographic dividend of our country. You know, the demographic dividend is we have more than 1.4 million schools in our country. We have 10,500 engineering and related institutions. We have 39,000 colleges. We have 150 million young students entering into the workplace over the next 5 to 10 years. And if you see what apps are all about, it is all about addressing this demographic dividend, innovative capability, as well as the needs which are going to be experienced by this young set of people who are going to grow and create the society that they want. And therefore, the biggest beneficiary are going to be those who are innovative enough and smart enough to see what the opportunities are to fulfill this very pent-up demand that our country has and which Sarita ji and both Jitin ji pointed out. The second thing is, I think it is going to be a combination of large companies and small startups who will be able to address and really create world-class apps. If you take if you take in the United States or for that matter, anywhere else in the world, the large companies depend upon many of these startups to come up with all these innovative applications and innovative technologies, which are getting integrated on an almost daily basis for them to make their things more effective. And that's the way it is going to be even in India. So unless you have this convergence of industry, academia, government, as well as NGOs coming together, you will not see the fruition of the initiative. And I also believe that you have a tremendous opportunity. Private sector has a great opportunity to play in this segment because this is going to create the future new India of our dreams. I mean, whatever has brought us here, a focus on rote learning and good education and getting good marks in the university and so on, has stood us well so far and created the industry in terms of the knowledge economy. But what is going to take us forward is this innovative quotient of coming up with world-class solutions, world-class technologies, and world-class apps, which is going to bring the benefits of the technology through the cloud and through the emerging technologies right to the doorstep of the common man. And that is, they are going to be the ultimate beneficiaries.
Okay, all right. So, Sarita, what's the best way forward then?
So, Frank, to me, I think one of the biggest advantages that we have is the fact that we have over 500 million internet users, a 1.3 billion population, a lot of these under the age of 25, we have a ready market. All we need to do now is to find those business models that actually can scale to serve these, hundreds of millions of users. And the other big advantage is that because we have such a, such a critical mass, whatever we develop, whether it's, artificial intelligence or, machine learning, all of this will be easier done because the government, I believe, is considering formulating policy that will, level the playing field somewhat and will not allow one or two large global companies to corner all the data of Indian users. If that is done, I think that, Indian startups will truly have the level playing field that they are looking for. I think that is going to be the game changer, if you ask me.
Okay, all right. And Jatin Jain, close the show for us with your concluding remarks on whether the IT industry is up to the challenge and what can we expect from the IT sector going forward?
Look, Frank, every strategic sector in the history of India or any developing nation nurtured and prospered when government mentored it. Be it aviation sector, be it nuclear power sector, or be it normal power sector. If our government was to consider startup as the strategic sector for the next two decades, we will prosper and grow. It is not about banning China to provide an uneven field or blocking them here, or it is unfair. Not like that. It is in our national interest. You must understand all these big startup giants in China, like Tencent, Alibaba, Weibo, or QQ, WhatsApp, they all thrived and grew behind the great firewall because China blocked everyone from outside, be it Twitter, Facebook, and Google. Behind that closed ecosystem, these startups thrived. Now the same sort of firewall is being in India. It is not only to protect from them to come and encroach and corner our data, as Sarita likely pointed out, it is also to provide a chance, a space for our startups to grow and take their time. So I think the results will come in next 2 to 3 years. Don't expect, that results will come in 3 months and somebody will develop and go popular. And that is the biggest mistake we make. We think that somebody should build a product which can compete with Amazon or Walmart these big apps or Walmart on the day one. No. Nobody can compete with Facebook or WhatsApp on day one, but allow them to grow, add them, don't pressurize them, give them an enabling environment with enough funding to survive. You can trust me, within 2 to 3 years, you'll see the results of Indian startups dominating the center stage in the world.
Okay, I've got about a minute left on the program. So, Mr. Ramanan, I'll let you have the last word on the program. Please be brief.
What I would say, Frank, is that all the people who are listening to it, take this opportunity and respond to the Bharat App Innovation Challenge. This is a wonderful challenge launched by Meti, MyGov, and Atal Innovation Mission. And we are very committed to finding world-class apps and the creation of world-class apps. And like I said, and as Jitin rightly pointed out, this is much beyond banning a few apps here and there. The opportunity is huge. And if you have to tap it, we have to approach it boldly. And we should be encouraged by the fact that our country has that talent and it has expressed itself in the rest of the world. So it can express itself here too.
Okay, all right. On that note then, I'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. What's coming out of this discussion is that the panelists are calling this the golden age for app development in the country. The talent and capability is there. Those who innovate and rise to the occasion are the ones who are going to benefit the most. It's an opportunity to build a new India of our dreams, and all stakeholders must come together and deliver. With that, it's a wrap. See you again next time.